Hello again, DDO World! Mara's Mara here, reporting live from the Canith server, where we're hoping to get a few words with those wacky boys from the DDO Players News. I would have tried to sneak aboard their respective airships, but the vessels are already so tiny that they probably wouldn't hold any passengers anyway. Oh wait, here comes the infamous Draculetta! He's like a vampire or something? Excuse me! Hello! Draculetta! Can you spare a moment for your adoring public?
Hello? Did someone say my name?
Down here! Hi!
Oh, it's a halfling.
Right. Congratulations on your anniversary, Draculetta. How long have you been married to Pineleaf Needles?
Thank you, but I'm not married to Pineleaf. We're co-hosts on the DDO Players News podcast. This is our 50th anniversary show.
A golden anniversary! How romantic! Well, I got you a few gifts to celebrate your nuptials. Here!
Like I said, we're podcasters, not newlyweds. And what is this? This is a pizza crust.
It was pepperoni.
Some used lottery tickets.
I totally cashed in the winner for you.
And a receipt for a 2-scale cardboard prop of one Jeets Shimmus?
Oops, that last one is mine. So anyway, I pulled a few strings at Turbine and got them to move your guild ship. How many other DDO players can say they have an airship waiting for them at the end of the Crucible in the Giant Hold?
Wait, what?
I know. You're welcome. I have to go find Pineleaf Needles now. Goodbye!
But my ship!
Hello? Excuse me, hello? Spare a few moments for your adoring fans.
Oh, hello there.
Hello, Pineleaf. Stormreach Action News here. You sure were in a hurry just now. Were you on your way to Korthos Island after dying in some horrible fashion, permadeath style?
I was on my way to the bank.
Oh, it must be hard to die over and over again in new and excruciating ways. I bet you know Korthos Island like the back of your hand. Maybe you can put in a good word for me with Jeets on your next reroll.
No, I'm not actually on my way to Korthos, and I don't know who you are.
I'm Mora, silly. Even the Turbine legal team knows me. They spelled my name correctly on the last restraining order I received. Fifth time's the charm, I suppose.
I have to go now.
But I have a gift for you. I heard you had a real problem jumping, so I snuck into the Bastion of Power to get my belt for you.
Oh, a gift? Thank you, I guess.
Well, of course, there is one little catch. To get the belt, you have to kill the Merilith, and I couldn't get her to just give it to me. So, hold on while I push you into this special dimension door. Just climb the Bastion of Power and kill everything you see, including the Merilith, who has lots of arms and swords and a long, long tail, all the while being mauled repeatedly by traps and Shavaroth creatures. What could be easier and more fun than that?
I don't think this is a good idea.
Good luck! Say hi to Jeets for me. Well, looks like my work here is done. Happy 50th podcast, DDO Players News. May you live long and prosper, or whatever. This is Mora's Mora from Stormreach Action News, signing off.
Good day, everyone. This is Pineleaf Needles, and welcome to DDO Players News, where we take a look at the latest news in DDO and here at DDO Players. And please welcome my co-host from Ravenloft, Draculetta.
Hey, everybody. I'm still trying to figure out how Mora got in here.
Oh, those halflings can be really sneaky. And tonight we have a gaggle of guests. And we have with us the damsels of DDO, which includes Saba Jade.
Hello.
Lessa.
Hey, hey.
Mithri.
Hello.
And also joining us tonight is Bonnie Bew.
Oh, hi.
You almost sounded like Mora there for a moment.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was confused.
I was thinking about how are you going to get to your airship?
Yeah.
Because I know how you guys are with the Crucible.
Never seeing that airship again.
Oh, boy. Time to upgrade.
And also joining us tonight is Community Manager Cordovan.
Hey,
welcome.
Thanks for being here. Appreciate it. 50 episodes, and it's great to be surrounded by a whole bunch of awesome guests. Here's how you get to your airship, an airship beacon.
Hey, right there
you go. Love those things.
Yeah. It was great to see Mora back. It's been a while. It's been too long.
It's sneaky little halfling. She only does special appearances, I think. Maybe if you tempted her with Jeet Shimmus, maybe she would come back more often.
Talk to me after the show.
Ooh, a Turbine in. I like it.
Let's head into the game news for this week. And the big news this week is that they have announced the changes for the Deepwood Stalker line of the ranger. And Drac, what type of ranger do you play?
I play an arcane archer, so I'm not real excited about these, though looking at over the proposed changes, I might actually roll up another ranger and I might try Deepwood Stalker.
Ooh.
Does anybody else play? I don't think anybody else on the call plays a ranger, do they?
Well, I've had a ranger over the years, but it was sort of a old Batman build. I've done some two-weapon fighter rangers, but it's been a while. But I think the Deepwood Stalker is going to be really nice for two-weapon fighters in particular.
Yeah, that's why I was kind of excited about it. Oh.
What would excite me, though, is if they ever have a Javelin Ranger.
Yeah.
And just
cricket. You have to get from my background.
Now, like have two Javelins? Two Javelin with your Ranger? Or Javelin and a bow?
How's that work? Javelin would be the ranged weapon.
Okay.
All right, so basically quarter staffs, you could chuck them, you know.
Are there returning javelins?
Well, unfortunately, I don't think they've got javelins in the game at all.
Be very careful when you try to catch them again.
All right. What are the highlights of the changes?
Some of them are in Tier 1. They're looking at upping the favored defense. The AP cost is going to be reduced to a 1-1-1, and that is no longer going to be a multi-selector, but instead it's going to give you the following benefits against your favorite enemies, plus 2, plus 4, and plus 6 to the armor class, or plus 1, 2, or 3 to saving throws. Also in Tier 2, the improved weapon finesse now is going to apply to bows, which that makes me excited because I usually take weapon finesse on most of my builds, and I'm glad to see that's actually going to apply to a ranger now.
We're also adding quite a bit of opportunity to get ranged power. I can't remember if it's in this one or if it's in one of the other trees that I guess you guys haven't seen yet.
Well, go ahead and tell us about that, though.
I'm anxiously awaiting.
I could say that right now we're looking at Deepwood Stalker. The Players Council right now is looking at the Tempest and also the Arcane Archer. For update 28 here, it's likely that we'll have Deepwood Stalker and Tempest to the live servers, and Arcane Archer is going to take a little bit more time to bake, so that'll probably be coming maybe in patch. Probably latest would be update 29, but maybe in patch. And mostly just because we have to be careful in how we balance Arcane Archer because of many shots. So, and you guys know what that's about. So,
then the most excited thing I saw in these proposed changes were in the Tier 4. You're going to get 30 points while wearing light armor. You're going to gain 5 physical resistance rating. So that is exciting.
I also like how it looks like Thrill of the Hunt's going to be cheaper. That is something when I spend in this tree, I go up to Thrill of the Hunt. Don't really go past Tier 3, but I like things that are cheaper.
So, and then in the show notes when this episode goes live, there'll be a link to the forum thread for all of these. It's a pretty long thread right now with, of course, players giving their suggestions on what to do or what to change or what they don't like about these proposed changes. And just keep in mind, everything you read now, of course, is all proposed. None of this is written in stone. And I'm assuming we'll be on Lamania soonish, maybe?
Yep. Our goal is to get an update to Lamania later this week. I would say sometime between Wednesday and Friday, maybe a little more likely to be Friday than Wednesday, but we'll see.
All right. Sounds good. So if we're lucky, it'll be this week.
No, it will be this week. Well, it better
be.
If it's not this week, then something happened. But it should be this week. Like I say, we're probably going to take Tuesday night's build and use that for our first Lamania preview. So assuming Tuesday night's build builds okay and gets checked out by QA and it nothing major broke or anything like that, and then we get it propped up to Lamania and checked out on Lamania and ready to go, then that's the process. So could be as soon as, let's say, late Wednesday, probably as late as early Friday. Like I say, if we don't get it up by early Friday, then probably one of those things happened. And then it'll be as soon as we can get it out. So,
all right. So anything else on the updates for the Ranger, or should we go on?
That's it. We can move on. Unless Cordovan wanted to add anything else.
Well, I could tell you that I don't have the tree in front of me, but I could tell you that one of the things I'm really looking forward to with Tempest is we're going to have a dex to damage option. So that's pretty cool.
Oh, that's awesome.
All right. Then let's head into the DDO Chronicle, issue 158. And the top picture is still looks like it's from the Archon series. We're going to be featuring those quite a bit in the near future, I guess.
Are you talking about, you're talking to me again?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I forgot what said. What were you asking about?
No, I know the picture at the top of the Chronicle.
Right. Yeah, that was from Update Trials of the Archons. And yeah, we'll probably see that, well, at least for a couple more weeks yet. Then we'll be,
Archons.
And then it'll be the other stuff. Yep.
Yeah, Akron's like kind of a big deal.
Right.
We put I don't know if you saw on social media over the weekend, we put our first screenshots out of Update 28, and it includes one of our new monsters. So, I don't know. Yeah, exactly. So I guess pretty soon we'll be starting to use that.
That mailbox wasn't a new type of mimic, was it?
It should be.
I was going to say, great, now you just gave them ideas, Bonnie.
Yeah.
Oh, man, boy. I should keep my mouth shut.
Right. I'll be right with you. I just need to go check my mail. Oh, crap.
It doesn't eat mail. It eats the people trying to get mail. So
it's... Yeah.
All right. No, actually, if it's one of those Evenstar mailboxes, the bird attacks you as soon as you get near it.
Well, that's what I think because I'm afraid of pigeons. So I don't like the Evenstar mailboxes at all because I do think they're trying to eat me. So I'm pro Eberron, Orion, Lightning Mail, or whatever. It's my favorite.
All right, Trek, what's in the Chronicle this week?
In the Community Spotlight, we have a new DDO player-created blog. It is the Saga of M... I should have figured out how to... Hey, there you go. Amistress, that sounds... We'll go with that. I did check it out a few times, and it looks like it's going to be a great blog. I did add it to my favorites, and I keep checking it every other day or so. So it looks like they're doing quite a bit of stuff on there, so... It's always good to see new blogs pop up in the DDO realm. And we have in the Fansite News, DDO Cast had a new debate. It was on low-level adventure packs. And a few of the people that partook of this is actually here with us. Bonnie Bew, Pineleaf, and Evennote, who, a little sneak peek for you, will be our guest next week, actually. And that is your fault, Bonnie. We're blaming you for having...
I think she brought it up. I'm pretty sure she brought it up.
Yeah, that's what she had said. And then she's like... And then, of course, well, you tweeted it. And yeah, so, yeah, so...
Yeah, I'm like, you can't just say things like that. And like, you can't just say, I've never been on DDO Players. I want to be on DDO Players. You can't just say things like that while I'm around. I will tell on you.
So,
ask her how many creature companions she has.
Even note?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I will write that down.
Yeah.
Could have been set to ask you how many creature companions you had. Okay, gotcha. But I think the lesson we learned from this is you never say anything around the damsels and you never say anything around Bonnie because they both make things happen. And in the case of the damsels, it's evil crucible thing.
So when are we going to do proof is in the poison with the two of you?
I keep telling you I'm busy.
Okay.
You don't listen to me, but I'm busy.
We're adding to the list, too. We're going to do the pit.
Yay!
Now, I never said anything about the pit, so
Pineleaf did. Just said something about the pit, though, so that means it's law.
I don't know if I mentioned this publicly or if I was just trying to troll one of the developers with this, but we need to do an epic version of the pit, and it needs to use the mechanic of Rainbow in the Dark, so you're in the pit, but the whole thing's in the dark.
Oh my gosh! Need a flashlight.
Oh my god.
I'm crying
That's
already.
Evil. That's evil, Jerry. I like the way you
it
say
it. It is.
Yeah.
Kui John in the chat says, the pit with no feather wall. Also, in the Chronicle this week, DDO Gamer has a great little wallpaper from the Temple of Elemental Evil, so check that out. And the House of Grouse looks at Devil Assault. And that is pretty much it for our Chronicle this week.
All right. And it looks like another sunset in the harbor picture for the screenshot of the week.
It's because DDO does great sunsets, Pine Leaf. Everybody wants to see a DDO sunset.
They do.
All right,
Or is that Three Barrel Cove?
Looks like Three Barrel Cove, I think.
Yeah, I was a little bit generic when I said harbor. I didn't necessarily mean.
Yeah, I say because Three Barrel Cove does have the prettiest sunsets in terms of port locations.
It's pretty good.
I think they have a slightly prettier sunset than the harbor, but I'm just a harbor.
But that is absolutely Three Barrel Cove, yeah.
All right, Drac, I heard a rumor that you have something to give away.
That is more than a rumor, Pineleaf. That is true. We do have giveaways. And also, if you are joining us in the chat room, there is going to be randomly throughout the show some Turbine Point codes that are going to be dropped in the chat room, and the first one to enter them gets them. And that is courtesy of our community manager, Cordovan. So thank you for doing that for us.
Oh, no problem. Glad to do it.
He has also graciously giving us a list, which I will be emailing you if you are the winner. And this is going to be for the live chat room right now. It's a list of items that you can pick from, and we're going to do this three times during the show. So three people will get to pick from anything from this list, and all I'm going to need from you is your character name and your server, and I will get it to Jerry, and he will pop you an in-game mail with the item that you picked. And there is some pretty interesting items on this list, I'll say.
Yeah, I think
notice
that's
you didn't
word.
Say powerful. Right?
Yes, that's right. I said interesting. So.
Yeah, but they are strong ammunition for when you're having a link war with somebody in a party chat or something.
Or to just strong. Say, have someone say, "What in the? How in the world did you get that?" And you say, "Well, you can't get it, but I did."
So what I'm going to do
I'm
is
be like, I'm kind of a big deal in DDO Players News.
That's right. What I'm going to do is I'm going to count all the people in the chat room. Then I'm going to go to random.org and put the number of people in. And that's how we're going to choose the winner. So I will do that right now.
For those who are familiar with other recent events, it's the loot list that I guess I need a better name for, but I'm calling the community loot list. It's the one that was, used for the recent 10-week challenge, McCarty Dio's 10-week challenge in that. So that list of items is basically the stuff I have to give away for events like this. And so that's what you can get picked from.
The dreaded RNG has given us a winner. It is Sweetie Nochi. I hope I said your
Sweetie
name
Nochi!
Right.
Nice. Awesome.
She is my guildmate. So yay, Sweetie.
Oh, woo! Awesome. All you're going to need to do for me, sweetie, is send a email to podcast@ddoplayers.com and just say you were in the chat, you won, and I will send you the link of the items you can pick from. Pick one of those, and then we will get your item to you. Actually, Jerry will get your item to you, but I will make sure he knows what you want off the list. So congrats.
I also happen to see in chat that I believe this is Sweetie Noche's first time listening to a podcast. So fun and profitable.
Yeah.
Oh, well, I hope it's because I told her as I logged off, oh, I have to go do a podcast now. I wonder if that's why.
She followed you.
Peer pressure.
You have a stalker, Bonnie. You have a stalker.
She's a nice stalker. Like Enrique.
It's podcast. I will put it in the chat, too. It's podcast@ddoplayers.com is where you need to send that email, but I'll drop it in the chat for you, sweetie.
All right, then. Now let's head into the store sales. And what's on sale this week?
The free sample of the week is a remove negative level potion. You can get that with the coupon code 81DDC. 81DDC. One per account. And finally, figure that code out. Go.
What, 81DDC? I'm sorry. I really...
Did I stump Pineleaf? I stumped Pineleaf from Pineapedia. Everybody write this date down in the calendar. Pineleaf was stumped.
I don't know if that actually means anything. I think this one might have been random, right?
It looks like it.
I mean, normally the codes kind of halfway make sense, but this one I saw and I'm like, yeah, I got nothing for this. And then also in the store, 40% off this week, augments, jeweler's toolkits, cosmetic armors, cosmetic hats, helms, and headwear.
Woohoo! Go buy something fancy to wear. It's a good time to be alive.
No chime in from Lessa on the cosmetics. I'm disappointed.
I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm so sad she didn't.
If it'll make you happy, I will go straight to the store right now and spend all of my turbine points on hats.
Go buy some glitter.
Oh, God.
Go buy...
Don't. Stop. Stop teasing me with glitter.
Go buy some glitter. Make yourself pretty. You'll feel special.
I would... It's funny because I would actually do it if it was there.
I think you'd at least do it for a pet. Make it feel special. You're bad.
I want to be wearing the glitter.
I'll let people know. You need to be a. Wait, you can only wear it if you're a pale master in vampire.
No, I want to be a paladin who glitters.
Yes, please.
Why? Shiny?
That's not going to do itself, Jerry. Let's go.
Gonna get some shine.
Right. Such pressure.
Why would we want glittered paladins? Why?
Why wouldn't you want a glittered paladin? Excuse me.
I'm a brilliant glittery paladin. I mean, it is like my holiness, just glittering off of me. Low.
My God is fashion. Yep.
My God is fashion.
Wow. Oh my.
Right. Let's head into the site news. And our first thing is to our favorite moments from the past 50 episodes. And Drac, you have some clips for this?
Yes. So what I did is I put a post up on the site and I asked if anybody had any favorite moments to list them. And I'd pull them and we would go back down a trip on memory lane since this is our 50th episode. We got a few responses to that. The first one is from Mookie Blaylock. And they said their number one favorite moment had to be the magic marker bikini story, which just so happens to involve Bonnie. So it's serendipity how this happened. That's right. So let's.
Of my childhood.
And this was, I think, this probably was one of my favorite moments from the past 50 episodes as well. But let's take a listen to that.
I like even asked for copies of Deities and Demigods and the Monster Manual for my birthday 1 year to hook my brother up. But because I was 10 and the Kelpies and the artwork had bare boobs, my mom bought me the books, but she drew magic marker bikinis on everything. So, and these were first edition manuals. This is how far back it was. So I look back and I think a couple things. That's my mom. And oh, the manuals. Oh, the humanity.
Exactly, marking up those first edition manuals.
First edition manuals.
I'm still weeping inside over that every time
magic
I
magic marker bikinis.
Every time I look at my first edition manual, I think, oh, magic markers.
I can still picture the Kelpies.
And Mookie Blaylock also had another one. He said the time Drac talked about his Ravenloft game and how the party climbed down the mountain face instead of going in the castle. This is a sore subject with me. If you listen to the podcast last week, you'll know why this whole Ravenloft thing is a sore subject with me.
This is my favorite ongoing thing, actually, because it's not just these two episodes that it came up. It came up in a lot, and you can slowly hear how Draculetta is breaking down.
Yeah, my party broke me. That is a good way to say it. So this one is a little long, so if you haven't heard this, you probably will enjoy this. So let's take a listen to hear what my crazy party did. I did do some Dungeons and Dragons related things. You can remember I've been talking about it every now and again. I'm running a conversion of Ravenloft to 5e, and I'm running that for a group of my friends who I'm going to just state now, and one of them is actually in the chat room now, so yes, you, I'm talking to you. You are the luckiest party ever on the history of the Earth that has ever played. Is all I'm saying. They are still alive. This is a party that refuses to die. It's like dumb luck. It's pure dumb luck why they're still alive. They're really in trouble now, though, because they're split 3-2.
Don't split the party!
And it's their own fault they got split, so they're not looking good.
So what's this thing about no armors and weapons and stuff like that?
Okay, so... if you're familiar with the Ravenloft
mod at all. You know, before you go into the castle proper, you're out on the grounds and you find the carriage house. And you can go in the carriage house if you want. And then behind the carriage house is like a stone wall. And you can look over the stone wall and it looks straight down the mountainside down. And you can see the village of Barovia. It's like 1,000 feet below you. Well, about 120 feet down, there is, for some reason, and why it's written into the mod, I have no idea, because you actually don't do anything with it. There's nothing in the mod that tells you what to do, so I had to make all this stuff up on the fly. My dumb party decided, oh, hey, look, 120 feet down, there's like some light and a small little platform. Let's try to climb down there. And I'm like, guys, seriously, you really want to? Yeah, we want to go down there. I'm like, okay, how are you going to do it? So they devised this plan to climb down there with, they actually survived the climb down. Well, okay, let me rephrase that. The first one that went down was the Dragonborn fighter. Idiot Dragonborn fighter. He gets down. He almost makes it all the way. And what I did is I made him every, I think it was like 20 feet. I made him do a dex check to see, you know, if they were still sliding down the rope.
He had appropriate skill?
He did.
Oh, okay.
He did. His final dex check, he was, I want to say he was about 40 feet from the platform. He failed his dex check. So I'm like, all right, you fell. Well, I calculated the damage, and he actually survived the fall because he was close enough to survive it. So I'm like, all right. So he's down there. So then the paladin's like, hey, I'll go down there too. So I'm like, seriously? Okay. So the paladin starts sliding down this rope. Well, he too failed his check, but he was a little higher up when he failed his check. So he actually got to -1 hit points in his fall. But luckily, the fighter was down there and had a healing pot, and he got him back up. So I was foiled at killing a party member that time.
And what's this thing about a dead vampire falling from above?
I was getting to that.
Okay.
So that leaves. Okay, so there's two of the party on the platform about 120 feet down. So the other three part of the party was still up at the top, right?
Right.
So I start going, okay, fine. You're going to play this little game where you're going to climb down one by one. I'm going to start throwing monsters at you. So I started out with a group of spiders that almost killed them, but they managed to survive it thanks to their wizard and his stupid fire, but that's another matter. So then I threw a group of vampires at them. Well, I think it was the barbarian, got the smart idea that he's like, okay, let me try to grapple one of the vampires and we'll just like fling him over the edge. So I'm like,
okay
sure.
You're going to win a strength check against a vampire.
And he did. He won. Like, that goes back to the luckiest party on the face of the earth. Okay. Matter of fact, rolled a natural 20 on that. And I was like, seriously? Really? So anyway. So he picks this vampire up and he flings this vampire. So being the evil DM that I am, I'm like, okay, you two that are down on this platform, you're going to have to roll a dexterity check to see if you move out of the way, because there's a vampire that's coming flying down from above you that is going to land on you. So the fighter got his dex check and he rolled out of the way. Paladin was not so lucky. So the paladin ended up with a dead vampire on top of him that almost killed him. It did a lot of damage to him. So then I'm like, all right. So then the wizard decided, oh, sure, I'll climb down there with you. So he climbs down there. And the whole time I'm thinking, okay, you're not even supposed to be here. So what am I going to do? Because there's nothing in the module to tell me, okay, this is what happens, you know, once your party gets here and this is where they end up. So I'm like, all right, fine. So once they got down there, I'm like, okay, what are you guys going to do now? So then they decided, well, we'll check to see if there's a secret door or whatever there. So I made what I thought was going to be a really high DC check.
Right.
And of course, luckiest party on the computer rolled the DC against to find a secret door. So I'm like, fine, you find a secret door. It leads to a cave entrance. So they're like, and I can't remember. I think the fighter is like, okay, well, I'll go ahead and go in there. Well, at this point, I'm like, okay, you know, I don't know what I'm going to do because none of this is in the mods. I'm just going to make stuff up. So I devised a crafty little trap for them. As soon as the fighter stepped through, a white replaced him immediately in all of his gear and his armor. And the fighter ended up in the white's coffin.
Okay.
So there's a white standing in front of them instantly, wearing all of the fighter's armor and having the fighter's weapon, which therefore the fighter is wearing what the white had on, which is basically a burial gown.
Okay.
So the wizard and the paladin managed to take out the white. And then I'm thinking, okay, these idiots saw what happened when somebody walked through there.
Oh, no.
The paladin's like, I'll go through next. And I'm like, seriously? Yeah, I'm like, seriously? So a white took his place as well. And I'm like, oh, my God. So basically, and then the other two morons that were up top decided, well, we're going to, like, pull the carriage out, hook the rope to the carriage, and both of us are going to climb down to this platform, too. So I'm like, okay, fine. So they got down there, and then the wizard's like, I'm like, okay, what are you guys going to do? And they're like, well, obviously, we can't go anywhere. And then I was evil to them, and I had something attack them, and it broke the rope. So now they can't get back up, and they can't go down because they don't have any more rope, and it's a long way down to the village. So their only way to go now is in.
I assume no one has a flight spell.
No. So, yeah. So I said, so what are you guys going to do now? And they're like, well, I guess we're going to have to go through. And then I'm like, are you sure you want to go through there? And the wizard's like, well, and then about that time, the cleric said, well, why are there two dead whites here? So I'm like, finally, somebody is thinking with their head. And then, of course, the wizard said, well, every time somebody walks through there, yada, yada, yada. So, of course, being the party and my friends that I have, they tell the wizard, well, go ahead and go through there and we'll kill the white that takes your place. So the wizard's like, okay, I'll go through. So the wizard goes through. So, of course, the white takes their place. Then they pick up all the armor that's in there, and they decided, okay, well, what would happen if we throw the armor through? So I'm like, okay, throw it through. And so they threw it through. Nothing happened. I'm like, you see the armor inside of the cave about 10 feet. So they threw all the equipment through.
And, okay.
And they're like, okay, so what happens if we go through? I'm like, well, try it. So I'm like, see what happens. So they go through, nothing happens. And they're like, but it happened. I'm like, nothing happens. So therefore, the party is now split. And two of the people have no armor and weapons. And the cleric, they managed to pry open one of the coffins. And I rolled really crappy. And the cleric managed to find a dead cleric in there that he replaced all of his armor and weapons with. So there is a wizard, a fighter, and a paladin. And the paladin is the only one that has armor and weapons. And the other two, the barbarian and the cleric, are in a different part of the crypts. Basically, what I decided to have them do is, okay, since you were stupid enough to do this, I'll kind of reward you. You're in the crypts where you need to be, but you were supposed to go through the castle to get here. So I have them in the crypt, but they're split, and I'm throwing traps at them, and I'm throwing all sorts of monsters at them. So next time we play, I guarantee them that they will die.
Didn't you say that last time?
I know. I keep saying that. And about the time we were getting ready to wrap it up, I looked at all of them and I said, why won't people die? All I ask is you people to die.
Well, they were related to Inigo Montoya.
Yeah. Oh, but I'm like, seriously, how can you? Every time they needed a good roll, they got it. It was just enough to make a check, or just enough to kill something, or just enough to do this. And I'm like, how are you people even doing this? So, yeah, so now my party is in the crypts of Ravenloft, and they're split, and it's going to be interesting to see what happens next time when we play to see if I can actually succeed in killing them, or they actually succeed in killing Strahd, so we'll see.
Next week, they're going to die.
Yeah, remember I said that.
You said that so many times.
Yeah, I did. I did.
Right. Now, Bonnie, I heard that you also had a favorite moment.
I did, and this was, I think this was an episode that had the damsels of DDO as a guest, but it doesn't actually involve them. It was a word from your sponsor.
It was, and since we have the damsels here, Lessa, I think you were the main spearhead of this. You want to explain this a little bit before we play it?
Oh, this is the Blood Tide Pirate Helpline, isn't it? The assassination helpline?
Yep.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I think we came up with this in the Red Eye Static group. We were doing that quest chain, that House D quest chain, and we
decided that one of the areas inside that the assassination center, whatever, that was where they field all the calls. If you're having trouble, you wanted to have someone assassinated, this is how you go about doing it. You have to go through, you know, there's red tape you have to get through. So there you go. That's everything. Even assassins have red tape.
Sheesh.
Hey, everybody, it's Drac here in post. If you would like to hear the Blood Tide Assassination Hotline skit, you are going to have to download the audio version. We are not playing it on YouTube due to the music that was used in the commercial. Sorry.
Not like how Riverbird in the chat is nice. Pressing two. Yeah, he's like, two!
Man's got to eat.
Now Riverbird says six. My sister's coming after me. So.
Now, Bonnie, I hear that you also liked a follow-up to an earlier installment we had.
Yes, yes. It was really one of my favorite things. I was like re-listening to a lot of the podcasts, and this whole saga with Drac DMing his Ravenloft campaign, it just kept going and kept going. And finally, in episode 49... we find out what happened in the end, how this whole campaign wrapped up.
Do we really have to rehash this again?
I think absolutely we did.
Because just as a little side note to all this whole week I've been getting texts from all my friends that are just saying, is Strahd still crying?
my one friend... Actually, brews his own beer, so he is going to make a new batch of beer, and it's going to be called Strahd's Tears. Those are my friends, folks.
Oh, wow.
Oh, with friends like that, who needs enemies?
I'm going to have a comment after this one that I think is going to be important explanation of a phenomenon surrounding you, Drac.
Okay.
But also, I think it's very important that we get like the whole story out there so that people who like the DDO players and people who aren't your friends but are listening for the D&D side of things, you know the backstory, because I think they need to give you some help in killing your friends.
That's right. All right.
Here we go. We'll rehash this another time.
And then I did this weekend on Saturday night. All of my friends got together and we finished the Ravenloft 5e conversion.
Ooh,
and that's all I'm going to say about that.
What? After all, we've been waiting for months to hear this.
Oh, you actually want to know what happened?
Yes!
I see. how can I put this in a family-friendly, politically correct way? I failed as a DM.
You failed as a DM?
I failed miserably.
What, you failed to tell a compelling story that got their hearts racing?
No, I failed to kill every single one of them off. They finished the module.
What, they killed?
They killed Strahd.
What?
They won. They beat it. They finished. No deaths. Nobody died. Ugh.
That is incredible.
I even threw a mummy lord at them. A mummy lord, finally. And they killed it as well.
I'm surprised it got out, because if I remember correctly, last time they were in the middle of an area in the sub-basement that they're going to get out of.
Yeah, they were like split. They figured out how to get themselves back together as one party. Before they went back together, the two of them were stuck to a chest that was actually turned out to be a mimic. It didn't even kill them. They actually managed to survive that. And then the other two that weren't with the other three managed to get in the room. And just as they had killed the mimic, and then the cleric had to do a spell to actually find them, because the room was magic, so they were in the same room, but they were in a different version of the room. So they did that, and then after they got out of that, they needed to go into one of the tombs to get the Tome of Strahd to find out what Strahd's end plans were, and that's when I changed it up, and I threw a mummy lord at him, because I figured for sure I'd at least kill one or two of them. I was trying to kill the cleric, but I didn't manage to kill him.
them, I did manage to give one of them mummy rot, so that was a plus. And then after they got out of that, I had three werewolves ambush them out in the hallway. I did manage to give one of them lycanthropy. So I did manage to turn one of them into a werewolf, so that was a plus for me. But nobody died. Nobody freaking died, finally. I failed as a DM. I hand my DM card in. But in my defense, I did find out that the conversion to 5e, it needs a little work. I'm hoping they actually release Ravenloft 5e, like, officially, because it will be balanced more. I think that's the only saving grace that they had. It didn't convert well to 5e. Because they lived, exactly.
But I thought that 5e is designed to be a little bit more survivable than 1e.
It is. See, that and that's exactly what I told them. I said, you know what? We play Ravenloft 1e or 2e. I'll kill all of you before you even get in the castle. And they said, I'm sure you would.
Yes.
So basically, my friends are all still idiots because they live.
Okay. Now, my question is that, did they survive the Dracolich?
There was no Dracolich. Two of my friends did say that. Because they said, you know, we would have been dead if there was a Dracolich in here. And I said, yes, you would have. I should have put one in. I thought about throwing a beholder at him. That was going to be my next move, but they actually found Strahd quick.
Ah.
But I tried everything to kill them off. And then I will, in the show notes, I will post a, when they killed the Mummy Lord, they pretty much knew who they were. I knew they were going to beat Strahd at that point, because if they could take out a Mummy Lord, I know they wouldn't have any problems with Strahd. So one of my friends drew a picture of what Strahd was doing at the time when his Mummy Lord died. And that's all I'll say. I'll include it in the show notes. It is priceless, the picture that my friend drew.
All right.
So, yeah. So that's my sad tale of my players outsmarting me and actually living through Ravenloft.
Okay. I'm glad I was muted there. In the chat, Gums Gang said, if Drac DM shoots in ladders, do you think he would add grease and spike pits?
That sounds like Drac.
And Jerry had a great comment in the chat, too. Do you care to share that?
Well, I'm just saying, for your next tabletop campaign, you need to have one of the members of the party infected by some kind of disease from Delure that can only be cured by the bite of a vampire lord. So their mission is to raise Strahd back from the dead.
I like it.
Oh, but I thought you can't raise a vampire from the dead because it would put him back to before he was a vampire, right?
You'll have to figure that bit out.
There's ways around it. It's strong.
Yeah. No, you have to bring him back to life, and then he needs to become a vampire again so that then he can. So you not only have to bring him back, but then you've got to find a way to finagle him to be become a vampire again. So, yeah, there you
but
go.
At least you gave somebody mummy rot.
That's right. And I made somebody a werewolf. So I have two things going for me.
And I've been thinking about your whole, because it's another regular theme about your random number generator problems and how RNG hates you.
That's pretty well known at this point, yes.
And I'm beginning to see this kind of dichotomy, this kind of balance of power between like your friends and you, that they have this really great luck with their RNG, and you have this horrible, horrible luck with your RNG. Maybe they're like RNG vampires. They're like psychically sucking away all of your RNG luck.
You might be onto something there.
So maybe next time you DM, you need like a tinfoil hat or something, or I don't know. I don't know how you protect against that kind of thing, but I really think, yeah. We got to save
I
RNG
think
somehow.
I think I'll take a stronger metal than tinfoil. Probably gold.
I don't know. Just don't give him any ideas. I'm sure one of them is going to fashion up a hat for me now.
You have to do it the old school way. You have to grab your entire, just grab a handful of 20s, roll them on the table, and then pick the one that's the highest number. And then you do that with each dice, and that's how you decide what dice you use for that day.
I did actually punish a set of dice, though, because I was rolling crappy. So I stacked all my other dice around that one dice, and I put that one dice in the freezer,
And then after it was in the freezer for about a half hour, I took it out and I laid it in the middle of all the other dice. And I said, this is what happens when you roll bad. And I took a hammer and I smashed it.
Ouch.
Oh, wow.
So hopefully my next dice, my other dice will behave now. We'll see.
I think Drak's scary. He considers smashing dice punishment.
And he did it in front of the other dice.
I did. I did. That's right.
The dice party.
This is what will happen to you if you fail me again.
No wonder your RNG is all jacked up. I don't even think you can survive. Like, you don't, like, a salt circle and a Faraday cage. It's not even going to do any good for you. You just give up.
There's, like, this underground dice resistance going on that...
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, yeah.
That's it. There is an underground dice movement going against Draculeta.
Viva la dice revolution.
All right, Drac, do you have something you wish to give to the chat room or have their comments scared you away?
No, but I am laughing pretty hard here. Let's bring it back to the show here, folks. Yes, we have more of the items that you can pick from. Once again, just like before, if you win, send an email to podcast@ddoplayers.com. I will send you a list of said items. You pick one from the list. Send me your character name and your server. I will pass it along, and you will get an email from Cordovan with your winnings. I will head over to thedreadedrng.org and pull the winner. So give me just a second. I was going to say, we need some, like, Jeopardy music or something here.
Like, DNS cannot find the RNG.org site. It's like rejecting drag.
And looks like Ninth Pawn is the winner.
Yay, Ninth Pawn!
So, congrats to you once again. Yay. podcast@ddoplayers.com. I'll send you that list, and you can pick. And we will have one more of these later on in the show.
Very well, then. Let's head into our DDO players poll, which asks the question, are you looking forward to Sword Coast Legends?
Yes, 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 I am, Pineleaf.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you for asking.
Yes.
What did our members say?
Well, we had 47 total voters this time around. And let's see, the winning vote with 26% of the vote was maybe I plan on waiting till it comes out, then watching some videos and reading some reviews first. 21% said, nope, don't care at all. 19%, yes, I have already pre-ordered. 19% also said, Sword Coast Legends, what's that? 13%. I do. 13% says, yeah, I plan to buy it when it comes out. I just haven't pre-ordered yet. And 2% were the famous other comments. And one of those was from Edric, who said, Sword Coast Legends sounds like a fun and interesting game, but I just don't have the time to devote to another game. DDO just takes up the majority of my time. And the little bit of extra time I do have goes to Neverwinter Nights 2, which I will give you Neverwinter Nights 2 because that was an awesome game and still is a pretty fun game. I actually played that a couple weeks ago. I reinstalled it, and it's still a fun game, so I'll give you that, Edric.
And Keyjohn also said other. I'll pick it up on Steam when it's on sale, but not been caught up in any of the promotional hype around this one. Now Fallout 4, on the other hand, high expectations for that one. That will almost certainly eat into my DDO time for a while.
And besides Bonnie, we know Bonnie's excited for it. Is anybody else looking forward to it? Silence says no. Okay, Bonnie.
What? Well, oh no, I'm looking forward to it also.
Yeah, I'll for sure play it. Like, I play every D&D game. Giving a personal opinion on it would not be a problem.
I think the most exciting thing I'm looking forward to is just the fact that you can actually DM. I can DM for a group of people.
And now that's translated to mean I can kill lots of people.
Well, maybe.
I can express homicidal tendencies.
You could try to.
It'll be okay.
People.
We all know how well that worked out last time, finally.
Yes. Let's head into our screenshot of the week. And, Drak, I heard that you tried to take two of them.
Well, there is. We had a bonus screenshot of the week, and there is a reason behind the bonus, and you'll find out in a moment. But the real screenshot of the week is our number 32. It comes from Edric, and he entitles this, The Kobolds Have Found the Colossal Crystal. It's a pretty little nice screenshot. You can go over to our site and check that out. And then later in the week, I got an email from Bonnie. And this was just too good not to post. So I had to do a bonus screenshot of the week for this one. If you listened to the show last week, which Bonnie was on, you know what this screenshot is referring to. She did it, folks. She actually did it.
It wasn't the bloopers, because, you know, sometimes we talk a lot before and after the show proper.
Right.
And we were talking about screenshots, and I said, you know, I can't take pictures in real life. What makes me think I can ever take a screenshot? And I was like, if there's a way to take a screenshot of DDO and get, like, my finger and my thumb in it, I'm going to find the way. And so this is proof that I can find a way to just mess up screenshots, period. It's a nice little picture. I was in The Devil's Details, which I'm going to talk about more later. And there's my favorite character, Zoisha, and she's trying to wave to Eretricos. And oh gosh, and there's this huge finger. I guess I guess I got it over the lens when I was taking my screenshot. Yeah, that's typical for me. I mean, and I'm going to bring up Kijan here because we've talked and we've like just rhapsodized about the Stormreach campaign that he put together. And I was looking over that this past week, and it just, the pictures alone are amazing that he has documenting Stormreach, and that's amazing. So I am the opposite of Kijan. That's what I am.
All right. Now let's head into the news beyond DDO. And we'll begin with the Rage of Demons. D&D minis are now available from WizKids. So if you want some minis, they're more available.
Yeah, and this, of course, is the Rage of Demons, which is the new storyline currently going on in Paper D&D. The Demon Lords, of course, are invading the Underdark, a deadly subterranean realm inhabited by the most dangerous monsters of all D&D lore. And these, I did in the article I put up on the site, put some screenshots of these. These are some pretty sweet looking minis.
Oh, yeah, especially the one on the bottom you could have used in that raid.
Yeah, the white Dracolich. Yeah, and the deal with the Dracolich is there is one of those in every case that your local game store gets. So those are a very super limited edition mini, and you have to be lucky enough to get to your friendly local neighborhood game store in time to get that, because they're only going to get one per case.
Wow.
You get a Dracolich, send it to Drax. So
yeah, exactly. But yeah, that's pretty sweet looking. Packs are, you get three medium or small figures, random of course, and you get one large figure in every pack, and those are $15.99. for the booster pack. So that's about what all the other packs have been priced at. And the Dracolich, if you are lucky enough to get that, is $29.99 is the manufactured suggested retail on that.
All right. And it also looks like MMO Reporter had some coverage of Sword Coast Legends. And looks like three episodes worth.
They did. They were at PAX doing coverage. They did some excellent coverage of all things PAX Prime 2015, actually. But I noticed they did get a chance to have an interview with the narrative director, Jay Turner. And then they also got to sit down, and I must admit, I am very, very jealous of this. They got to sit down and actually play the game with some of the devs acting as the DM, and we're kind of guiding them through the playthrough. That is another video you can check out. And then finally, they did record the entire Sword Coast Legends panel that was at PAX, and they released that for our enjoyment as well. So thanks to the fine folks over at MMO Reporter for all of their hard work at PAX Prime 2015 this year, and especially for their Sword Coast Legends coverage.
All right. And Bonnie, you had something to say?
I have my own piece of Dungeons & Dragons news. It's coming up. Wizards of the Coast is going to be doing another Twitch marathon. It's going to be coming up between October 2nd and the 4th. And this is going to be an Extra Life marathon, something that Turbine also does. I know Cordovan and Tolero have done their own marathons in the past, raising money for Extra Life and to benefit Children's Miracle Network Hospitals. So this is at least the third time that Wizards of the Coast has done it. They're going to be doing it on Twitch. Last year, they raised over $85,000 for the Children's Miracle Network Hospitals, and it was freaking hilarious and adventure-filled and awesome. This year, their goal is to raise $100,000, and they're almost doubling the length of the game. They're going from a 25-hour marathon to a 48-hour marathon on Twitch. So if you're interested in watching the Twitch tabletop excitement, make sure you follow Wizards of the Coast on Twitch. Their handle is WOTC_DND. You can find out more juicy details on the Wizards of the Coast website, including a schedule of who is playing and DMing when. And not to put anybody into a tizzy, though I am already in a tizzy because I'm super excited. I cannot wait to watch this because it was so entertaining last year. But Chris Perkins he's currently scheduled to DM on Sunday morning from 8 a.m. to noon Pacific Standard Time. That's 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. Eastern. I'm so excited. Some of the people, like almost everybody who participated as players is coming back this year too. And some of them are in Chris Perkins' group, and they were super entertaining last year. So I'm mega excited. Rodney Thompson is also going to come back to DM on Friday night. I'm excited about him.
Who is an excellent DM as well.
he had a part to play. He was part of the team who did the Player's Handbook for 5th edition. But he is also one of the creators of Lords of Waterdeep game.
Oh, really? And nice.
So the reason why Rodney Thompson is so important to me is that game has a quest in it to domesticate an owlbear. So I think of Rodney Thompson as, you know, one of the forerunners in terms of owlbear rights out there. And, you know, owlbears as pets, and what could go wrong there? So I'm really excited about seeing Rodney Thompson come back to DM. And lastly, I'm going to mention that Keith Baker, you know, King O'Eberron, he's going to be playing on Saturday from 8 a.m. to noon Pacific Standard Time. So tons of awesome people to see who have been involved with Dungeons & Dragons past, present, or peripherally, or somehow, or maybe somebody lost a bet to them. But it's going to be a good time. So if you can tune in during those 48 hours, it'll be entertaining, and you'll also have opportunities if you donate to Extra Life during the stream. You can do things to tweak the game and what happens. You know, you can name an NPC or throw something horrible at the party, I'm sure. Lots of things. So it's worth checking out. And so I provided the links that will be on the show notes, I think, where you can look up more about the schedule behind the marathon stream on Twitch. And also linked where you could donate directly to Chris Perkins, not because I'm biased or anything.
Yes, Dan Kimber in the chat asks, so are you a Chris Perkins stalker?
I am totally not. Wait, it's not a stalker if you get there first. And
okay.
But no, yeah, he's one of my favorite DMs. But it's all in all, it should be entertaining. There's so much good playing. Like, the characters that people created were wonderful, and I had a blast watching it on Twitch last year, and it was for a good cause. So I just wanted to kind of shill that, because it's 2 weeks away.
Oh, that's very cool.
And Mock Taskmaster in the chat says, that is an amazing all-star cast of players and DMs, and I would have to agree. Mm-hmm. They are loading that stream up with some talent.
Yeah. Like, oh god, I can't remember his name. You know how I am with names. I'm like, Rich, the guy who is behind Pathfinder 3.0, he was a player last year, and he's going to be a player this year. And wow. Oh, I hate that I can't remember his name. But his shtick this year is you can donate, and he's going to be casting spells, but they're going to have one letter changed. So if you've ever wanted to see, like, Chair Missile cast or Magic Missive, a spell, or maybe Hold Parson, you know, maybe he'll allow Bacon of Hope instead of Beacon of Hope. Maybe he'll allow that spell. I don't know. But this is going to be your chance.
Oh, that's brilliant. That's
in
great.
In a live setting. So check it out.
All right. Let's head on. Bonnie, I heard that you had a couple of favorite moments.
I had way too many favorite moments. So I tried to restrain myself a little bit. But I think almost all of my favorite moments are in the bloopers. So if you listen to the YouTube podcast, you might not always get them. But if you listen to the download version, or you actually listen to the podcast compilations that you guys have put up sometimes, you might know what I'm talking about. The first one was when I guested, I think it was in May, episode 31, and it was before the show started, and we were talking about the next module that you'd like, classic module, you'd like to see translated into DDO, and I was talking about this module. I was trying to remember the name of it. I couldn't remember the name of it. And I'm saying, it's some Aztec-y thing, you know, and you have to race to get out. And then Pine Leaf just drops into this kind of, would you like some Grey Poupon voice, as if he's opening up Masterpiece Theater. And he's like, oh yes, I played that the first year I went to Origins. It's the Hidden Shrine of Temo-chan. I have a copy right here next to me. You know, it's amazing.
Classic Pine Leaf.
You can picture it, like he's sitting in this study, you know, in this like big chair, and he has all these like D&D guides behind him in the bookcases, and there's a fire burning in the fireplace, these modules stacked up next to him in show notes. That's how I picture Pine Leaf now, all the time. And, of course, another one of my favorite notes, one of my favorite things was in episode 48 when we were talking about the DDO screenshots, but we already talked about that. But another moment that was my favorite was at the end of that show, which was part of the show, because we were talking about the Stormreach campaign that Kijan put out there. And we were talking about how people who are fans of lore, who are interested in learning more about the lore of Stormreach, are going to be amazed by this because it puts some things together and tells some stories. And I'm talking about how wonderful lore is and how my favorite thing about, I think, update 24 when Orchard of the Macabre went epic was learning more about the story behind the Abbot and Lady Vol. But for the life of me, I cannot remember Lady Vol. I am totally freaking out. And you guys did this epic job of dealing with me going runaway train. Because I'm just like, I'm blabbing. I'm like, oh my God, I have a DDO wiki emergency, blah, 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 blah. And it ends with me saying something like, it's Lady Vol. That's who it is. It's Lady Vol. I'm losing my mind. And Pyleaf just calmly says, all right then. And he closes out the show. It's like he can transition through anything. He can transition through a gelatinous cube or a chromatic ball, or I don't know. It's
again,
amazing skill.
Classic Pine Leaf.
Classic Pine Leaf. That is always my favorite moments is whenever there's something crazy going on and then Pine Leaf just calmly carries on. It's wonderful.
He does have a knack for transition. That is true.
He does.
Now, let's give the damsels a chance to talk about any of their favorite moments.
I was just about to say the damsels broke Pine Leaf once, but I can't remember what it was about.
Oh, that's right. You did.
Yes. We broke him.
What episode
like,
was
completely.
That?
Completely.
Oh, my gosh. If I made a note of that.
I think it was like the first time we had all three of you on together.
I think that was from like
that'll do it.
Five,
yeah.
But what was it?
And you did, but I can't even remember.
Maybe Saba remembers. She has one of those steel trap memories.
I can't even remember now what.
Oh my God.
What happened? And I think it was just because it was like all three of you and it was just too crazy for Pine Leaf and he was just like, I'm done.
There was talk about new player races that was going everywhere. There was talk about some guy who was had a Kickstarter, like where you're paying him to print his product or something.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yeah, he wasn't selling. Yeah, that's right. That weird Kickstarter. He wasn't selling the product. You were just helping him print the product.
In a printed copy. And then there was something about.
As a gift, he gave you the product that you paid for, but you really didn't pay for it. That's right. Yeah.
And then the big 1,000 kind of Kickstarter donation was a free trip to meet up with this person or something.
Right.
It's totally free. You just had to donate $1,000 to print his product, to help him print you a copy of his product.
That's sort of like the equivalent of mailing yourself a letter for copyright or something like
yeah,
that.
It's, yeah. And I think I kind of said that on the show too, because I was just trying to figure out, I'm like, now exactly how is this working? Because and the whole, like, he was basically making a module for 5e, and it was basically Ravenloft. But it wasn't Ravenloft, but it was, if that makes sense. And that's why he's like, well, you're not buying this. You're just helping me print this. And I'm like, right.
Oh, I just remember another one of my favorite things. It was from episode 34. And it was, again, is Pine Leaf talking about Storm Reaver Fresco and the crystals, having to beat the crystals. And I think it's my favorite soundbite. He's just talking about, I could just go bing, 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 on the crystals forever. It was the way he said it. It was hilarious.
That was when I was on the character that was completely unable to damage those that wizard.
I think it's sort of our goal to break Pineleaf and Draculetta. We've already broken Pineleaf, and now we're dragging Draculetta into every quest that he says he doesn't like, trying to force him to like it.
And take him to Crucible and get him his airship.
We've already done that.
The Crucible. Oh, okay. Watching Draculetta try to net. Well, we made him do everything.
Mm-hmm.
But watching Keyword him try to made, do the swim yeah, was the best. The
And then we tried to make him say he really liked it at the end. It didn't work.
And he wouldn't. He refused, but we knew that he secretly had a good time.
Yeah.
And I like how, Lessa, you're conveniently not bringing up how you left me in the water.
I had already gotten out of the water. I thought you were following me. You were still under the water. It's not my fault that you didn't follow me to the surface.
Ah, the usual excuse. All right. Do you have anything else to talk about?
Lessa?
Oh, me?
Oh, damsels
in
general.
Who's he talking to?
Whoops. You're our spokesperson. Go ahead.
Noah, I want to hear from Saba Jade. She has to have a favorite moment. She is a podcast lurker.
See, I don't have a favorite moment. I like listening to Pineleaf when he talks about his permadeath characters.
Ah, the saga of the permadeath.
Exactly. And every week I enjoy that segment.
Which, that has become quite the most looked for segment of the podcast, I think. I
don't know why it is, because it's...
Because you die in the most horrible ways, finally.
Yeah. And you have these strict, you have these crazy strict permadeath. You are very, very hard on yourself. I think someone actually said once that you play permadeath so hardcore that you kill yourself. I don't remember who said that, but somebody said that.
You're kidding me.
No, yeah, somebody said that in one of the shows. I just remember something about Saba Jade that I thought was funny. When she was telling the story, it was during the Mimic Festival, and Saba Jade was sharing the story about how all the mimics were eating Lessa.
We don't have to talk about that. You don't want to. That's cool. We could go on to something else. This is really about Draculetta and Pineleaf.
All right.
It's like talking about it really calmly and gently, and it, you could tell, like, under her voice that she was really, really happy about all the mimics eating you. like getting back for every time that you never listened to the rogue or made a halfling joke.
The chat room is demanding to hear the story, Lessa. So the public is out crying for it. You have to tell the story now.
No, I'm good. Seriously.
I have a feeling the chat room is begging for another giveaway.
No, actually, they're still wanting to hear that story, but give them a giveaway instead, because Lessa is just going to hold out on it. I blame Lessa for everything. It's all her fault.
Give it away like a permadeath or dying at the hands of a mimic.
Here's a story about when Lessa was the rogue in our party and she killed me repeatedly.
That has nothing to do with Draculetta. Remember, we did stuff with him, and this isn't about how I killed you or how I killed myself with mimics several times. But we're good.
In a row.
Yeah, well, honestly, the first time I was surprised. The second, third, and fourth time, it was my fault. I knew that there was a risk. And I did nothing.
All right, then. With that note, let's go to the third giveaway.
All right. The winner is going to be Brogan. You just won yourself one of the items. Email podcast@ddoplayers.com, and I will get you the list of items. And as the previous two, same deal. Pick one of the items off the list, and you'll get it delivered to you in-game.
All right, then, with that done, since Cordovan was nice enough to provide us with these little gifts, let's see if he has anything he wants to talk about.
Well, I guess if you ask me about favorite moments, I can't really think of any. Not that I don't like your show, but it's just I spend all day every day listening to podcasts, and I can never remember everything that's been said. I have to admit, though, most recently it amused me very, very much to hear you talking about how it was a bug that monsters could be damaged by traps and quests, and that maybe we're going to have to fix that one, because that was amusing.
Yeah, I do regret saying that now.
I just yeah.
After I've been told several times.
That's part of why it's so much fun to your podcast.
Yep, though. Absolutely.
Because
yeah.
you get that first reaction to some things.
Yep.
And it's like you don't really think about, oh yeah, I could see where someone might like look at it that way. That's always fun.
Well, I like it because it also made me think as like, okay, so that is, you're probably, I mean, if you have an opinion, there's probably 100 or 1,000 other people with that opinion. So that means there's a whole bunch of people in game that think they're getting away with a bug when they're accidentally killing a monster in a trap or something like that. And that amuses me as well. So,
yeah. Hey, Bonnie, do you have anything you want to talk about?
Oh, dear. Do I ever? Well, I have two things. One of them is shorter, and it's really more like a discussion question amongst us all. And then the other thing is something that I have a lot to get off of my chest about. So I'll start with the discussion thing. So episode 18 of DDO Players News was titled Bacon Beats Everything. All right. While episode 48 was titled Chris Perkins Trumps All. So I got to ask, what would happen if you had Dungeon Master Chris Perkins, you know, Dungeon Master par excellence versus Bacon in a showdown? Who would win?
Ooh.
See, and I'm afraid of the answer. It's
why can't he just be I'm eating really bacon the and answer. Then everyone wins?
So therefore, you're saying that if Chris Perkins was DMing for bacon, I would think that you would have the most massive game ever in history of D&D.
If bacon beats everything, would bacon beat Perkins? That surely that is a so.
But what if Chris Perkins really is bacon?
Oh my god!
See?
That would be like so cool!
See what I did there?
I get that. I can live with that answer. Power of bacon.
All right.
My other thing is, well, it's kind of like romantic issues. Like sometimes I go on about like how many different DDO NPC boyfriends I have, because I have a lot, and I'm not going to talk about them. I think I'm going to save all that for some other podcast if you guys like ever invite me back or something. This
you're
is about
timing Michael the Pie.
What? No,
if you're not married, you know, you can have multiple boyfriends.
Apparently, yeah. He didn't put a ring on it.
Yeah, right. She didn't say they were going steady, just said she has boyfriends, right? Yeah.
It's already long enough, so I figured I couldn't go into the whole history of my dating life in Dungeons & Dragons Online, because that would just be too much information. But I'm saving it. Maybe some other time, if Drac and Pineleaf are brave enough to ever have me back, I will go into that information. But this is about Eretrekos, okay? Now, I think I made it pretty clear how I feel about Eretrekos. I love Eretrekos. I go and shroud all the time. Every chance I can get, you know, shroud, 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 because I want to give him those hairy hugs. And I love doing Tower of Despair. And I think Eretrekos is my number one red name. You know, he is my favorite manifestation of evil in Eberron, bar none. So when Update 27 came out with the Trials of the Archons pack, I was super, super excited because they're like screenshots of Harry. Yeah. So I was totally jazzed to see Harry again. And until I went to go do the devil's details. Because like the first time I go into this fortress and I see Harry, there's this like barrier between us. And it's not even like a metaphorical emotional barrier. It's like this literal barrier. And I'm like waving and banging on and I'm like, Harry, remember me? Remember me from the shroud? But like Harry's just too busy complaining.
Like the graduate.
Yeah. Like Harry's just too busy. He's busy complaining about wizards for some reason. And okay, so who doesn't do that? But I'm like, okay. Poopsie Devil Lamykins has a lot on his plate right now, and he's distracted. Fair enough. So I let him go with his business, he's complaining about wizards, and I plan to catch up with him on the flip side, because I figured, you know, I'll see him again in this dungeon. So then I'm wandering around the opposite side of the fortress, as you do, and then there's this cutscene, like, almost in my face, but there's, like, another barrier between me and it. And I see Militia, and you remember Militia from, like, House Fialarn? I can never say it. and the carnival and the under the big top. And she also shows up in the Wrath of the Flame in Shavarath. So she has those Shavarath kind of ties, you know, she's a devil. And she's there with Harry's Lieutenant Hathera. And it's like she's bragging. She's like bragging all about departing the fortress with my beloved Eretrekos in tow and making a big deal out of it. Like they're a couple or something. And ooh. I'm like, what the horoth is going on here? Like, is that succubus trying to steal my DDO devil boyfriend?
Well, she is a succubus, so, you know.
I mean,
she can't help it.
I honestly do not know what to think.
Funny.
So I'm disturbed, and I go to the end of the quest. Yes, Lasso.
He's just not that into you.
No.
Sorry.
He is.
Oh, snap. Like, okay.
So I go to the end of the quest, and I'm, like, standing right in front of Eretrekos. And Harry wasn't even talking to me. No, he's, like, chatting up the succubus, and he's crying about wizards again, and he's playing with his portal, and he just up and leaves. And he doesn't even talk to me, as if I don't even exist. And I think that all this time in Shavarath has gone to his head. Like, he didn't handle the whole shrinkage thing in the Tower of Despair, in the Tower of Despair very well.
There was considerable shrinkage.
There was considerable shrinkage. But I really thought... I really, really thought that all those times he whispered "Eberron burns" in my ear, that it meant something. And now he's gone back to Eberron, and people, I think we're just going to have to do another hug intervention to save Harry. I mean, ditching me for a succubus? I mean, in the immortal words of Belle Biv DeVoe, doesn't he know that girl is poison? Or at least, like, an energy drain, you know? But I don't know.
Wow.
Maybe Harry likes that kind of thing.
Bonnie will go down with this ship.
Apparently
so.
She won't put her hands up and surrender.
He does that whole pitfing Condrain, ouchies in the shroud, and he's always like giving me devil chills. So I know that's how he flirts. And I think, you know, we have a real connection here. So I'm just saying, I'm upset. And I'm concerned about your Eretrekos and Militia, this whole situation. And I think come update 28, there is going to be a reckoning. The end.
All right.
I just had to get that off my chest. I feel very strongly about it.
Very well. I've got
some advice for you. You know, he's an army general, politics, you know, on the devil battlefield, all that sort of thing. So what you need to do is find, you know, go out with, say, like First General Horoth, you know, that sort of thing. You can go out to the devil's battlefield with him. And while you're there, you can just sort of, you know, make eyes at Eretrekos so he gets jealous, you know?
Yeah. I think part of the problem maybe is that I'm, like, Blade Forge or something right now. Maybe, like, if I reincarnate into, like, a rogue where I can have Invenom Blades, he'll respect me more.
Oh, that's probably true. Yeah.
I don't know. But yeah, I just had to get that off my chest.
All right, then. Let's head into our weeks in DDO. And Draculetta, what were you up to?
I did not do a lot this week. I was busy in real life. But I did do something on my level 15 rogue. I noticed I had a bunch of quests that I had in my log. For some reason, I've never done. I don't know why I picked them up and then didn't do them. So I decided, you know what? I'm going to start clearing some of these house quests out so I can complete them. And then move on to something else. So I was in House K, and I did the Caverns of Kamara, and I did that on Elite, because, of course, I was way over level for it.
Right.
So I did an Elite, and it still was kind of challenging, actually, for me. There was one part where I almost died, but that was a fun quest, and that was the first time I've actually been in there.
And all right.
That's really about all I did, other than what I did with you on... our Wednesday weekly playthrough, which you will probably talk about.
Right. On my level 15 Artificer with Draculetta, we went to Evening Star, and we ran Escape Plan, then Shadow of Doubt. And then after that, we went to the Weyloon Prison to do Friends in Low Places. And, well, I had done Escape Plan and Shadow of Doubt before. This is the first time that I was inside Weyloon Prison, and that place is really weird.
Well, it is a prison, after all, Pinely, if I mean.
Yeah.
And
Did you drink the Kool-Aid?
Can I just say one thing about Friends in Low Places? Why does that chick complain that we killed her brother and her sister so many times?
Yes.
It's like, just shut up about it. So we killed them. Move on with your life.
She's very emo.
Yeah, exactly.
Totally.
Attached to her
sister. You just don't understand me. Why?
But yeah, so what did you think about your first little glimpse of Evening Star, finally, and Weyloon and all of that fun stuff that we're going to get into?
Well, let's see.
is all of it going to be this weird?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yes.
There's some it's weird stuff happening to Wayland.
This weird.
Mm-hmm. Weird things are happening in Wayland and Pinelane.
All right, then. On my paladin, on the infamous permanent paladin, at levels 3 through 4, I did not find a creative way to die. I'm sorry to disappoint you on that. I went into the Cerulean Hills and did those two quests there. If there's a third quest in the Cerulean Hills that I've been missing all this time,
No, it's the two.
Okay, just those two. All right, fine. Though I do have to admit that maybe someday I will stay in there a little bit longer so that I can at least find all of the rares, because I've yet to find all the rares in that place. I don't think I've found all the landmarks yet there either. Yeah, I was doing the harbor where I did a couple of all the stuff with Baldry and the shipment and all that fun stuff you got to do. Plus, I did the refugee toll where you talk to that guard. And
yeah,
I had a paladin here with a decent charisma and an intimidate skill up through the roof. So I just says, all right, you want their head smashed with a mace? And he goes, oh, yeah, okay, you go through. And then I went into the waterworks and did those four. There were a couple of cases there where I thought I got a little bit close to having a brush with death, but I managed to get through it okay. Though it would have been nice if my cleric stuck to me a little bit more closely on a couple of occasions. So, Saba J, what were you up to?
Well, I didn't play much this week either. I had internet problems. But Myth and I went and did the 3 flagging quests for the new raid. And we didn't do it for that reason. We did it because we're looking for loot, and of course, we didn't get anything. But I like the new quests. They remind me of the old Shabra.
Yeah, I like them too.
They're kind of fun.
All right.
We were trying to sneak in that one, and Myth can't sneak for anything.
No. It did not work out. She snuck by everything, and I was just like, okay, there's 5 guys in this room, and I can't kill
they
all of them.
Because
the last room we left me in, I used half of my mana already, and there was only 2 guys. So she had to come back and get me. But
were you munching on goldfish at the time?
Shh, don't tell.
Okay.
All right. Lessa, what were you up to?
I let my Permadeath Paladin go ahead and level to 22. And thank you very much, Draculetta, for plugging the crap out of the tutorial videos that I made with her.
You
did it like it was your job. So I started plugging away at XP for her, and my high level Permadeath group, the Sitting Ducks, we hit 28 this last week. That was fun.
Nice.
Yep.
So now what are you going to do when you hit 28?
Well, we're debating whether or not we want to do an epic TR. I think I've finally persuaded them, but some of them are still on the fence.
You're not going to wait for the level cap increase?
I don't know.
Well, you should probably at least wait until update 28. Then you can run the high level stuff, and then after that, then you epic TR, and then you've got until 29 comes out to be back at high level again. Uh-huh. Which you could probably do fairly all right.
Yeah, I think so.
All right. Mithri.
Well, that was pretty much all I did was the Saba Jade. But I do have a question. Pineleaf, did you hear the birds in Evening Star when you were there?
What about the birds?
Did you hear them? Didn't you tell me?
Well, yeah, I did hear the birds when I was near the mailboxes.
See, there's birds.
Those pigeons.
There's more birds than that, though, Pineleaf.
I was telling a story about Saba Jade and I strolling down the bank of the river there, and he says, birds? Because I said the birds were chirping. There aren't birds. Are there birds? Just wanted to make sure you heard them.
Yes, I heard the birds.
Good.
All right.
The other thing, I have one complaint that I have to mention every time I can possibly think about it. way back, several updates ago, they broke my water savant, and nobody has fixed her yet, and I don't want to know why.
Oh, are you talking about the particle effect where they're not shattering on death?
Yes.
Yeah, that bugs me as well.
Sucked all the fun out.
Yeah. Yeah, it's on the list of things to look at, but I don't know. It didn't prove to be an easy fix, so it's going to have to take some more digging.
Well, I'm glad to
figure out the heck we did. Yeah.
Thank you.
Right. And Bonnie, what were you up to?
I'm just saying, I took advantage of the 30% heroic XP bonus last weekend and played Zoisha. Because I had reincarnated her into a Bladeforged Paladin, slash 2-Weapon Fighting Tempest. And I hadn't really done much on her since Update 27 came out. I mainly did epic stuff. So I got her to level 17 and did some of the normal stuff you do. But I did the Trials of the Archon quests on Heroic Elite for the first time because I'd only been doing them on epic. And I hadn't done them on Heroic. And by the time I did them, I was level 17 and I was pretty cocky about how spectacular I was. But they just wiped the floor with me. Those Archons hurt my feelings.
What?
They were mean. I think part of it was, like, in the first quest, which is my favorite one out of them, and it has that kind of Sumerian kind of artwork thing, and you have all the different, you have all these different trials and stuff. And I get to the Trial of Constitution, and I think it kind of, like, jerks, because they're like, oh, we got this Trial of Constitution, what should we have you do? Oh, yeah, there are all these devils and demons and stuff in our courtyard. Why don't you just kill them? And, yeah, that's your trial. And I got there, and that started to make me sad. I think they were picking on me like Mean Girls as Archon, that whole prove yourself to the Archons thing. I think it's just hazing.
Yeah, I could see the comparison.
But yeah, that was my week. I kind of went from 15 to 17.
Gordon, what did you do?
Well, I have to admit that I didn't get as much game time in as I normally do because there was an event called the Boston Festival of Indie Games this weekend. It took place on the MIT campus, and I'm a volunteer for the group. I actually run their like Facebook and Twitter feeds. But I also have been volunteering every year to do everything from like set up tables to man information booths and all that sort of thing. So a lot of my week was set aside helping to get that thing off the ground. Because they have about, it was like 3,500 or so people showed up to it, so it's a pretty big event. And it's kind of a big Boston game development scene kind of shindig, so I was, you know, hobnobbing with people from the local area that are making games and stuff, both tabletop and video games. So that was a lot of it, but I did get to, on my Wayfinder group this past week, we were trying to get through Don't Drink the Water, but In the Belly of the Beast. And we tried doing it on Epic Hard, and it's just three of us in this static group this past week, and I don't know, we just couldn't get it done. I don't know why it's so difficult, because normally I can get through that quest pretty good, but we ended up just getting slaughtered in the arena fight a couple of times, and so we're like, well, okay, let's head over to Manectarin then. And so we did that instead, and we did Whiz King, because we're level, by the way, we're level 23, so yeah, we're not. And this is our first life up to 23 as a group, because we created group the characters together and are leveling up together. So that was what I did on Wayfinder. Then on Thalanus, I was on one of the guild I'm usually in there, and we just hit level 20, so we were like level 18 to 20 over the weekend, and we did the missing quests on Elite Harbinger of Madness, including In the Flesh, and that actually went really well. It's amazing how much a level 18 warlock can make a difference. I think we mostly did the missing quests, and then we finished up flagging to get into Evening Star, so that now that we're level 20, we can start doing the King's Forest chain and all that sort of thing. So that was pretty much, and then everything I did in the live stream. And then also I did get a chance to run through the Update 28 quests on our internal environment, because, you know, we're getting ready to bring that to Lamania, so we need to have people take a look at that. So I was doing that, and otherwise I was just working a lot, because we had besides the volunteering, this is a busy time for us right now, what with, we had some issues with Asheron's Call, if you know about that.
I heard a rumor that they tried moving.
Yeah, we had some data center issues, and they are now in a new data center, the same one DDO is heading toward fairly soon here.
Okay.
And then, you know, just, I was putting together release notes for Update 28, and we're organizing sort of our walkthrough with our licensors and things, so blah, 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 other things. So that was my week that was. Say something. One thing I got to take a look at this past week is something that is in a very early state right now, but will probably be coming for Update 29, and it may slip out of 29, because we have a pretty ambitious Update 29 with, you know, Epic Shroud and an adventure pack sort of flagging for Epic Shroud. What I guess I could say, Update 29 is going to include Epic Hound of Zoriat as well.
Oh, cool.
And on top of that, if we can get it in, it may be after 29, but it may be in 29, We're going to do Epic Tempest Spine.
Oh, that's awesome.
So,
yeah. God.
So I was in some meetings about that and organizing that this week as well. And that's been kept me pretty busy. So.
All right. Yep. Maybe someday I'll get a character high enough so that I can see what this epic stuff is all about.
Well, you can run the heroic versions now. You know,
yeah.
Yeah.
So.
But yep. The character you're running with Drac is getting on up there. I mean, you guys are doing like you're level 15, 16, something like that.
15 right now.
Yep. Yeah.
So you're practically there.
You're practically
there. At level 15, you could do Hound of Zoriet on normal with the group. If you can find your way there.
That was an evil laugh.
Yeah.
Well,
Pine Leaf is directionally challenged, so...
Oh, so much the better.
Oh, no.
By all means, go to the subterranean.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, so clearly Update 29, I mean, if you think about what we are already saying we're going to do for Update 29, you know, with Epic Shroud and the Adventure Pack and the level cap increase and Epic Green Steel, and then potentially, most likely Hound of Zoriet Epic, and then possibly Tempest Spine Epic, and then also maybe trying to squeeze in Caneth Crafting if we can do it, but clearly we're telling ourselves we're going to do a lot for Update 29, so it wouldn't surprise me if some of that ended up kind of slipping just due to us being perhaps overly ambitious. But it's on that could be well in there as well, so we have our work cut out for us for the next...
There was no squeal at Alessa on that one.
I couldn't breathe
for a second. What are you doing?
Super exciting.
Yeah. I need to know.
Are you asking for a friend, Alessa?
Yeah, just for a friend.
Well, I can tell you, at the very least, one of the things we'd want to look at is the thing that the community's long told us to do with Caneth Crafting, which is to try to scale it up so that it doesn't really sort of end at around level 20, right? Mm-hmm. People want to carry it all the way up. So since we're going up to level 30, we're going to need to do some adjustments to random loot as part of that, because, you know, you have to when you increase the level cap. So I think we're going to assign the person who's doing that to also take a look at Caneth Crafting if can. And so probably on the minimal side, it would be some kind of expansion of Caneth Crafting up to level 30. And more ambitiously, we're going to smooth out some of the rough edges of Caneth Crafting and maybe perhaps make it a little more intuitive.
All right.
Yeah.
Now, Drac, I hear that there's going to be a giveaway on the Stormreach campaign.
If you remember a couple episodes ago, I think it was episode 48, we talked in depth about the player-created Stormreach campaign. What it was is on Monday nights, there was a static group on Galanda that their name is the Monday Marauders. And they went through and did a year-long tour of Eberron. And to give the group an old-school campaign feel, the player by the name, well, he's Deadlock on the forums. He's also known as Quijon. I don't know. I'm probably pronouncing that wrong, but I'm going to go with Quijon. He created what basically is a narrative story of the entire Dungeons & Dragons game. It is amazing. You can get the free PDF of it right now, and we did link that. Do you want to say something, Pine Leaf?
Did you say the entire game?
Well, the...
All of Eberron.
Yeah, the...
Oh, okay.
Eberron section.
Yeah, because it's called Stormreach Campaign, I was saying.
Yes, I should have said the Eberron section of the game. So, well, as a little thank you to his static group that ran this with him, he printed some hardback copies of this. There are only 25 of these books in existence, and as a full disclosure, he did send me one as well, just for kind of a little thank you for doing the podcast and everything that, you know, we're doing for the community, so I want to thank him for sending me that. But he graciously donated a copy for us to give away. So you are going to be able to get your hands on, and it's a pretty thick hardbound book with color pictures. And
gorgeous pictures.
Yes. If you've read the PDF, you know what it is. But just imagine getting this in book form that looks like a Dungeons & Dragons module book. If you can imagine that, this is what you will hold in your hand. And I'm going to do a post tomorrow on the site at 10 a.m. that will explain these rules as well. But what we're going to do is you are going to have to go in game and send us a picture of a vampire in the game. Any vampire, it doesn't matter which one, just as long as it's a vampire from DDO. You will send that to us in game, and then everybody that does that will put your name in the pool, and then we'll draw. And then I'll get your name and your address, and I will give it to Qui-John, and he is going to send this to you. Now, it's going to come international post, but he is going to pay for all shipping as well. So we want to thank him for that, for doing that for us as well. So once again, you're going to get a hard-backed printed version of the Stormreach campaign. And can I mention, Jerry, that there is a copy of this at Turbine as well?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, you sent a copy of this to to the Turbine offices, and we have it in our D&D/DU library.
So...
And it was actually cool, too, because, you know, there's so much detail on the quest, and throughout the past, I guess, week and a half or so since he mailed it to us, some of the old DDO devs who, you know, have moved on to other projects just because that's the way business works, are coming back and they're looking at their own quests to see what he wrote about them and things like that. So it's pretty cool. Yeah.
So yeah. So once again, there will be a post up that will explain all these rules if you can't remember it. But the basic gist of the contest for this is going to be: you need to take a picture of a vampire in game, take a screenshot, send it to us. We'll put all the entries in. We'll draw a name from the entries. And I'll get your name and your address, and he will internationally post you a copy of this book. And it is amazingly done, and it's awesome, and it is a collector's item for sure. As I said, there's only 25 of these that were printed. And so just think, you can show your friends and say, I have a copy of a book that is setting that the devs at Turbine look at. So that's a pretty cool little thing. You can tell your friends that you have a copy of a book that is setting in Turbine, and there's only 25 of them in existence.
Nice. Rare.
Yes. And you'll have probably, I'm going to let this go for 2 weeks, I think. But the contest will start tomorrow morning at 10 a.m. Eastern time. And there'll be a post on DDO Players. And I'll also put it on the fan site section of the forums as well.
All right. Now, if you'd like to help support DDO Players, you could simply go to the donations page where you could support the Players Alliance on Patreon. There you'll find rewards, including a mention on the DDO Players news, or even be a guest host with us. And we have a featured comment from Bonnie Bew on Swan Diving Dritz. Bonnie, what did you say?
I don't know. Should we? Now that I've listened to the whole roadmap, I'm thinking maybe I was just having a crazy kind of like no madness moment for the first part of this. But I thought at one point last week that like the planes were like intersecting, and that I suddenly understood life and Dungeons and Dragons and DDO as we know it. But now I'm doubting myself. But I was thinking about how like the last Acquisitions Incorporated at Hex Prime, and I was thinking about the Rage of Demons trailer. And during Acquisitions Incorporated, Chris Perkins, who I can only mention yet another time,
cough stalker.
I had something in my throat.
He highlighted how with the coming, you know, Rage of Demons story, Wizard of the Coast campaign is going to the Underdark with Les's boy toy Dritz. And in his
That's
campaign,
gotta be my boy toy.
It is totally your boy toy. Don't deny it.
I was gonna say there's no denying that, Les. No denying that.
In his campaign, there were some deep gnomes that showed up. And so this reminded me of something that Seth had said on the forums like way, 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 way back in the producer's letter. Okay, so I have in here, who am I kidding? I can't remember things. I was actually listening to DDO Players episode 19 at the time, and it said that Seth said something about deep gnomes on the forums months ago. He said something about deep gnomes. So that like kind of put the synergistic like craziness in my head about gnomes, 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 deep gnomes, Rage of Demons, Rage of Demons. We're going to get Rage of Demons and there's going to be deep gnomes. And I went crazy. But now that I like, and now that I've listened to Cordovan talk calmly about the actual timeline, I don't think that's ever going to happen, but I will still dream about it. I will dream about deep gnomes.
And now I'm thinking that Bonnie has a deep gnome spy contact, kind of like X-Files.
And Les is boy toy Dritz. But yeah.
I'm just thinking about we should have a raid where basically Dritz is in handcuffs, tied up with a bunch of the driders. Surrounding around, you know.
Yeah.
Oh my. Oh.
And there's like a little. There's a little note you can click on that that's from Lessa that you can find. Some notes from Lessa. Don't untie the drow.
Leave the drow for me.
My second comment was about the traps. That how you can totally use dungeon traps to damage monsters. And like, there's a classic example is when you're in the Kobold's New Ringleader. Once you pull the ruse to open up the door to get you to the end part of the dungeon, inevitably there's one kobold that wants to run up the corridor and hit the alarm gong to summon more kobolds. But it triggers the fire trap, and it typically gets roasted to death. So that's something that always happens. You can see it also, like, if you're doing, I can't remember it, hole for reinforcements. It's the first one in the Coin Lord's, Lord's March Plaza chain, when you're going to the beach and you see Droam invading forces. At the end fight there, there's a whole bunch of fire traps again, and the people you're fighting, they're not as careful as you are, I guess, and they'll, like, just stand in front of a fire trap and get toasted a little bit and get primed up so you can, like, stab them and punch them in the face and stuff. So there's lots of ways you can use traps to kill things. And then my very last comment was next week's poll. Next week's poll should totally be voting about what module Drax should use to kill his friends in his next campaign, because they have it coming.
They do have it coming. You are correct. And they know they have it coming, too.
So that's my suggestion for next week's poll. Tomb of Horrors.
I've threatened him with Tomb of Horrors several times, but I said, we're doing it old school. We're doing it 1E. You're all dead.
Okay. Tomb of Horrors is notorious for killing people before they get inside.
You're darn right it is.
Yeah.
Yep.
I've DM'd it, I know. Yes.
We'll show them the killing Strahd. I was fighting back earlier when you were talking about the giveaway of the wonderful Stormreach campaign, that anybody who sends you that picture of Strahd probably should get disqualified. Because not only is it not from in-game, not in DDO, but it's just like adding insult to injury.
That's right. Strahd pictures is an automatic disqualification.
Automatic disqualification.
And Quijan also sent us a comment. It says, has Pineleaf managed to catch up with Acquisitions Incorporated and the Stormreach campaign yet? Most traps kill mobs is one of the cool tactics you can employ. The exception that springs to mind is the Force Bridge in parts 3 and 4 of the Grey Moon Chain, which should kill the ogres, but doesn't. Traps killing mobs is entirely working as intended. And an extra thanks for introducing Titan's Grave. Can't remember exactly when it got mentioned, but took the time to look it up and have been really enjoying it.
Yeah, it's good stuff.
All right. And have we given anybody out the 5 gold in a party yet?
Nicely played, Pineleaf. But you didn't answer him. Have you caught up with Acquisitions Incorporated?
Have I caught up with Acquisitions Incorporated?
I'm
trying to remember what Acquisitions Incorporated is.
We talked about it, finally. Were you not listening to the podcast you were on?
Go check the episode 48 show note, and you'll find out, I think.
Okay, it slipped my mind.
Or finally.
You've been around me too much.
Oh, my. That's funny.
You can email us at podcast@ddoplayers.com. You could also follow us at Twitter, The Players Alliance at Players Ally, DDO Players at DDO Players, Draculetta at Draculetta_72, Pineleaf at Pineleaf Needles, and I presume our fine guests have their own Twitter accounts?
Do they?
Yes.
I think Saba Jade should have to say it. She's always making fun of me for spelling her name.
I don't know if I can remember everybody's. Let me see. Mine's Saba Jade. Mithri is Mithri 2014? No, Mithri 4. No. Mithri 1. Lessa is Lessa. Anything else, Lessa?
No, that's it. Oh, wait, you said Twitter. He didn't say email, right?
Well, you can do emails or whatever, too.
Okay. Lessa is Lessa at DDO Cocktail Hour.
Mm-hmm.
And Mithri, that's Mithri 2014 at Gmail. And that's Mithry 2014. Lessa, Lessah at DDO Cocktail Hour.
And you're trying to leave yourself out like, conveniently, but it's Saba Jade, all one word, SABAJADE@gmail.com. Email her early and often, and she will always respond promptly.
And all email sent to Mithri needs to have the subject line, "You are the center of the universe."
Yes, it does. And just a reminder, we're having our next pod, our next Twitch feed tomorrow night, 11 Pacific. We're going to do epic stuff.
Cool.
Yay.
Right.
Fun. And I guess I am on Twitter. I am Bonnie Bew. That is BonnieBew.
I could say if you want to follow Dungeons & Dragons online, it's twitter.com/DDOUnlimited, facebook.com/DDOUnlimited, twitch.com/DDOstream, youtube.com/DungeonsAndDragons, one long word, no ampersand. My personal Twitter feed is twitter.com/JerrySnook. And I kind of have a semi-private Facebook, so I don't really give that one out too much. But if you find me, which is not too difficult because Facebook is all about finding people, feel free to friend me, and I'll probably friend you back.
The Players Alliance has two live shows every single week. On Mondays at 8:30 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time, we have DDO Players News. And on Saturdays at 8:30 p.m. U.S. Eastern Time, we have Lotro Players News. And you can join us for our live shows at ddoplayers.com/live. Be sure to tune in next week when we will have as our guest Evenote. Well,
yay!
That is all for tonight, and this is Pineleaf Needles reminding you to blast those bugbears.
What do bugbears ever do to Pineleaf?
You pronounced owlbears wrong.